bullshit.
Just did breaking news. No more bullshit. No more bullshit.
No bullshit.
Ain't nobody listening. Some goddamn fuck in the Philippines hijacked my Facebook account.
Yeah. What a nightmare. Thanks a lot, Philippines.
Yeah, fucking move the fuck, face. Man, I'm sick of Facebook.
I know, it's the worst.
Can't keep it secure. You gotta be moving over, folks. Move over to YouTube. Just start, do it. If you can hear me, if you're one of the two people listening, go to YouTube and look up No BS News Hour or The Americans with LaDuff. You know what? And Zuckerberg ain't on there. God! Liven up!
Great way to start.
So liven up! Live on Facebook at all, guys?
Huh? Somewhere we are.
Where are we being shit?
I usually share it. I can't find it.
Well, there we go. The fuck?
Well, people are listening. People are downloading, right?
I don't know. Cabrera, man. You in Texas, man. Keep your hands off my body, dude.
I don't have to worry about that.
Y'all telling a woman, like, you have a neighbor snitch on a woman getting an abortion. What's up with that?
Hey, you know, their body, their choice. They can do what they want as far as I'm concerned. As long as I don't got to pay for it, hey, I'm good with it.
I like that. I don't want to pay for it, man. You know, everybody consider adoption, for God's sake. But then, don't you think that's funny? Leave that on. Leave that beep, that nice rhythm on there. Because I'm real upset. I thought the Filipinos were our friends. We must be awesome. You're stealing our account. We are awesome. We're on the border today, man. You listen, why I'm so stirred up is I'm working so hard. I talked to at least a dozen people, Congress people, Catholic Charities people, reporters, Border Patrol. It's nuts. It's nuts. Nuts.
It's a disaster.
You're nuts, dude.
Can't wait to hear from Cabrera.
You're nuts, dude.
I'm nuts?
No, your nuts are on fire.
Oh.
Not today, gentlemen.
Oh, no, God, no. There she
Karen,
is.
Don't be a cold shower. This is the day we need jokes.
Cold shower?
Yeah.
When Karen needs a cold bath, she goes into her basement, which floods every time it rains. I mean, Jesus.
Oh, man.
Or say, hey, all my new Filipino yeah, friends. Yeah. Jesus! Shit! Yeah.
Whoever stole that account, can you make sure to share this on that account?
I worked all these years building that account.
Yeah.
Turn ourselves into the number.
I can't find it. I can't find it anywhere. I usually share it, but I can't respond to all the wonderful people that listen. But
that's
I can't
because
find
you,
the live feed.
You don't speak Tagalog.
I guess not.
Tanakalay.
Man, look, I tell you what. All right, just right now, leave that stuff up there. Just give me in a better mood. I just, yeah. I'm just, man, from the governor to electric highway, yeah. Right? Yeah,
that's a good one.
While we're sitting here in the dark again because it rained a little. What electric highway? Well, it rained and our power's out.
Yeah, an electric highway in a state that has some of the worst electricity and worst highways.
Yep.
Right.
And remember I told you guys they were repaving Jefferson? They just did like the two lanes in both directions, not the center lane, not the bike lanes, not the parking lanes. Like, who's deciding to do this stuff? That's pretty elementary to me.
Thanks for localizing it. You know, we not only do international news, we do very specific local news. So you over there at Kirchival and Gotha? Goth?
Yeah, she's out of the house, though. That's good, right?
Well, wait, how is it pronounced? Goth?
Gothy.
Gothy.
That's how they pronounce it on over here.
The Germans call it Goethe. Or maybe they
remember,
don't.
Like we told the guy, you know, he was saying Freud, which is actually right, but over here we say fruit. So
yes.
you gotta know the East Side lingo.
You know how they pronounce it in the Philippines?
How?
I don't fucking know!
Charlie LaDuff.
Yeah. I've been to the it's the first time I've ever been in the Philippines.
Well, congratulations.
What the fuck? I can just tell you, sawadee ka.
Do a little. Well,
thanks for that. Hello. Fucking ripping me off. You know what ripped me off?
Who?
Probably some like sweet looking young man who does a really good did it my way at the karaoke bar in the fucking Manila. God. So listen there, Cabrera, listen, of you know, the National Border Patrol Council. Isn't that the thing, though? Like, keep your hands off my body, say the anti-vaxxers. Keep your hands off my body, say the pro-choicers. Isn't it really just fucking leave me alone?
Hey, I think it's live and let live. I mean, it's your body. If you want to put that mess in there, you put it in there. I mean, I personally got vaccinated. My 13-year-old son, I'm kind of against him getting vaccinated. I don't think there's any benefit to it. Matter of fact, a couple of weeks ago, he ended up COVID positive, had it for 4 days and good to go, you know?
So no problems with it. Your kid had COVID?
Yeah.
And then he got the vax too?
No, he hadn't got the vax. I'm against him getting the vaccine. My wife's for it. So we're kind of a little bit of a debate there, but
look, I mean, at that, look at that. Kids, you know, regular American, same in my house. Okay, so does your kid go in person to school?
Yeah, he's been going in person to school for, they only missed, the last half of the last year, I guess, a few months, and then they were back last September.
Is he wearing the mask? They got to wear the mask in the school?
Yeah, they don't have to. It's optional. They can wear it if they want. They don't have to. He wears it sometimes, you know, depending on who's around him.
I dig this. Reasonable young people. See, now my daughter and I, we had the Rona. Got the vaccine. All right, I waited 180 days because of no real science. Mm-hmm. Every day there's some other new science. I just take it upon myself. Then I got it. I wore the mask all the time when they told me. I wear it now. Leave that on. I'll tell you when to take it off. Did the fucking Filipinos just stole my music? it's helping me. Okay, I got the Rona. I got the vaccine. I wore the mask. I wear it where they expect it of me. Am I the only one doing the science? Why does my kid, who got it, got vax, has to wear a mask all day long, and yet the governor, all the politicos, the super elite businessmen, and the piggy press who pretends like they're all pals, they go up to Resort Island in Michigan to do a 4-day retreat to discuss our business, and nobody's fucking wearing a mask. The governor shut everything fucking down. You know, everybody knows Whitmer. Where's the science, baby?
She seems to be done with the whole thing.
She seems to be done because it's an election year.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Why didn't they ask her about it? We'll get to that. But first, we're going to do the border. Man, I don't know, Cabrera, you've been on this show like a couple years now, right? We like to keep track of the border, we being a border state. We were in on this baby early. We knew that words matter. You whisper words from Washington, they make it all the way to Tierra del Fuego. The whole continent here. Not a whole world's hearing. Where else are people coming from? We're going to do all that. Let's talk about those horses.
The Philippines?
Come on! Come on! Just flying to Mexico. just wait. Listen. You know, no bullshit. No favor. No political position except sense. First of all, always remember, this microphone here brought to you by American Coney Island at the corner of Lafayette, Michigan Avenue in downtown Detroit. The originators, the creators of the Detroit Coney Dog. Is that the best dog you've ever had in your life, Cabrera?
It is. It is a very good hot dog.
I said, is it the best?
It is the very best.
The very best. All the way from Houghton, Michigan to Houston, Texas. Everybody knows. And there's Mark. He just ate another one.
Shout it. Well, we had a lot of time.
Yeah, we did.
I went down yesterday, Charlie. I left my castle and went down to, what? And I saw Grace. Got a hug and a whole 3 bags of stuff.
You hugged. You like Grace. Yes. Grace, yes. Is in the middle of like interacting with the public. You, not. Did you wear a mask? No.
I had it on. I took it off when I got in. I had it on though.
You walking pile of pestilence. How could you do this to us? Well, listen, if you don't want to wear a mask and you don't want to get the vaccine, I don't care. Why would I care? If it's if it's as deadly as they say, you're all just going to die. Right?
That's right? What they say.
Sure.
Yeah, well, anyways, brought to you by American Coney Dog. The cleanest, the hippest. And look, let's end it with the Coney Dog chat. I love the guys at Lafayette.
Not even close.
Oh, no, 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 no. I mean, not even the flavor. Just, you know, I mean, like, can you, you know, can you use them up? That's what I'm saying. I mean, you all with this shit, you don't know anything. I'm the world's expert on this thing going on. Oh, you wouldn't believe what I hear down there. But anyway, American Coney Island. And if you want to get a Coney kit, it's getting cold. It's football season. Go to AmericanConeyIsland.com. Get a dozen dogs, all the fixings. Ship right to your door. Now, I want to do this. I want to apologize, MetaGuy. Sponsor of ours. We're glad to have him. I've been calling him, at least I did last week, I called him Medicare Guide. Mm-hmm. It's MetaGuide, but MedicareGuide.com is where you find him. And what this is all about, as you know, regular listeners who no longer listen to me, Filipinos. Since you're going to be getting on the plane, crossing the border, and being in here, look, Medicare is very complicated in America. The government makes all sorts of rules and regulations. It seems like there's 100 rules just when you're about to sign up for it. And if you do it wrong, you could be dealing with late enrollment penalties for life. This is true. Just another thing with this government of ours. Then you have to worry about what's covered and what's not, whether you can afford prescriptions or even see the doctors you want to see. And of course, the government doesn't make it easy, right? That's right.
No.
They're working at home. Mm-hmm. Of course, it's not going to be easy. So what do you need to do? You need to get a hold of MetaGuide. The licensed agents at MetaGuide do nothing but Medicare all day long. You call, they answer your questions. They're local to Southeastern Michigan. Right? They're local. Doesn't matter, Texas. You can call them. But if you want to meet them face-to-face, you can go there. They make sure you understand your options and pick the ones that are best for you. And best of all, their services come at nothing. It costs absolutely nothing. It's a friend. Their services come at no cost. And so when you're turning 65, and that's something I didn't know, basic, if you're turning 65 or ready to retire. What does that mean?
What does it mean?
What if I want to retire before I'm 65?
Who do I call?
What if I want to wait till I'm 67? Do I have to sign up at 65? That's the whole deal. All right, listen. Call MetaGuide at 888-970-2940 or go to yourmedicareguide.com for an appointment. All right? And my apologies.
It's good.
For screwing that up last week. But you know, I mean, we're all family.
You made it good.
We're all family. Speaking of family, this one, this my cousin over here at ADR. You know what that means?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Advanced Derivative Resources. You know what that means?
No, I don't know.
That means if you want to advance, you have to derive something from your resources.
Oh, okay. That makes total sense.
Right? It's pretty simple.
Yeah.
You need help getting... Give me that music. I said I told you.
It's only 3 minutes long.
I told you when I want the heartbeat to go down. I mean, I'm stressing. I worked so hard for you this week.
Those damn Filipinos.
Listen, investor can't get straight answers out of City Hall. Of course you can't, because the feds are fucking raiding it. It's another thing I worked on.
Yeah.
Trying to get those...
No lie, man.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Freedom of Information Act is stiffing me. Breaking news. I'm preparing a lawsuit to sue the city of Detroit for slow walking and denying me information entitled to me under the state's Freedom of Information Act.
Really?
Good. Yeah, it's the same with Governor Whitmer in the nursing homes.
What are they charging?
Sometimes they're charging $18,000. Sometimes they're charging $3,000. Sometimes they delete emails. Sometimes they pretend like they don't hear you. You got 3 weeks to get it to me. Not 3 years.
Good. Sue them.
Oh, I got the statistics. Okay, you running for re-election, Duggan. Let's talk about the children. That's coming. Hang with me, all three of you, and everybody in the southern islands of the Philippines. It's going to be great. They still speak Spanish in the Philippines, don't they? They were colonized by the Spanish.
Were they? I don't know. I mean, aren't they named after King Philip?
Well, I got to do everything.
Yeah, you do.
Mark, I thought you knew everything.
No, I don't know anything.
You know a little bit about everything.
I don't know anything.
I know what Mark knows when he's got something to do with construction, deconstruction, demolition, rehab, and project management. I tell you right now, who do you call?
ADR.
Yes. What's the number? I told you. 248-318-9424. Like it rhymes. Remember that? 318-9424. Yeah, on the 248 area.
48318.
Okay. Mention the No Bullshit News Hour just so he knows you're listening, Philippines. Oh, by the way, if you're calling from Manila, you're going to want to dial 1-248. Okay. Dos cuatro y ocho. 318-942-4. Okay? And remember, number one, and in the beginning of all, number one, like America, number one. Because we invented the fucking telephone and everything else.
Mm.
We're good fucking people. Don't push us too hard. All right.
Invented Facebook, too, that you stole.
All right, here we go. Leave that on because I'm liking that. All right, Karen.
Yes.
I want you to ask me this question.
Okay.
Gun to my head, would I vote for Trump or Biden? Okay, go ahead and ask
me. Charlie, yeah. Should I do visuals? If I were to hold a gun
pause,
to your head.
We'll edit that in post. Go ahead, because nobody's watching. Go ahead.
Okay. If I were to hold a gun to your head, who would you vote for? Wait. Trump or Biden?
Do my name in there.
Like Charlie LaDuff.
Oh, hey, Karen. Good afternoon. We're going to edit this.
Good afternoon, Charlie LaDuff.
Hello,
if I were
Karen.
To hold a gun to your head, who would you vote for, Biden or Trump?
Oh, my God. It's so funny you'd ask. So if you were to hold a gun to my head and ask me who am I voting for, Trump or Biden?
Mm-hmm.
I'd say pull the trigger, motherfucker. Oh, bada bing. Oh, there's too much gunshot, too much violence, Mark. Wow. Look at that. Mr. Mayor, we got problems. That's the deal. Okay, that's the deal. So I'm sick of talking about Trump. He's gone. He's gone.
Exactly.
He's done. I judge the person in office now, and I'm not seeing it. The border, which was calm. You gotta admit this. The border now is absolutely and historically, in the history of this country, out of fucking control. No answers from Washington. I told you, hipster talk in government leads to disaster. Joining us now, friend of the show, you know him, Chris Cabrera, the vice president of the National Border Patrol Council. Hey, Chris, let me start with this. We got hundreds of thousands of people coming a month, 100 plus. Let's be specific. What's the chick's name?
Jen Psaki.
Psaki. I want to say Psaki. Psaki. The White the president's spokesperson.
Press secretary. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, here's a Fox News reporter asking her about vaccinations for all the people, but just bum rushing. Let's listen to this answer.
Into the country, right across the river, does somebody ask them to see their vaccination card?
Well, let me explain to you again, Peter, how our process works. As individuals come across the border, and they are both assessed for whether they have any symptoms. If they have symptoms, the intention is for them to be quarantined. That is our process. They're not intending to stay here for a lengthy period of time.
Not intending to stay here for an extended period of time. So let me think about this. I'm from the third world. Okay, I don't like that term. I'm from the poor world. I'm spending everything I got plus a bunch of stuff I don't got, you know, in the future. And I'm only just coming for a vacation.
Yeah, no.
I just wanted to see what the hubbub was about. Chris.
No, you know, Charlie, the hypocrisy there on that with her is if you're coming into the country as a U.S. citizen, you have to show proof, right? Now, if you're coming into the country legally, as an immigrant on an immigrant visa, you have to show proof. So people that are coming in that are stating that they're only going to be here for a few weeks or a few months and then go back to their home country are having to show proof. But people that are sneaking in the country don't have to show any proof at all because they're not intending to stay here. Well, the group that's visiting on a legal visa has already told you they're not intending to stay here, but yet you're requiring proof. That makes no sense. She has no idea what the hell she's talking about.
Yes, it's bullshit is what it is. And I'm sorry, I'm nonpartisan. I know bullshit. I know it. You can't stand it. Put the gun in my head. You could pull it. I'm not doing it. I don't like being lied to. So listen, brother, what is the process? I'm told this. Like I said, I called a lot of people. We're releasing COVID positive migrants into the general population, are we not?
We are. And, you know, this is the silly part of it is.
Explain the process.
If we have a group of, say, like they were going to move out some unaccompanied minors to put them wherever they were going to put them, right? Put them in DHS or HHS custody, ultimately to their parents or their parents that are already here. So we had this group of 300 kids that were going to move out. Now, they pulled these 300 kids who were all in these cells together, and they put them in a big room, and they tested them. Now, about 30 of them tested positive. So they separate them from the other 270. Now, you would think that the other 270 would be quarantined, right? Nope. They just let them go. They just released them, knowing that they were just exposed to someone who just tested positive, knowing that the virus may pop up in another day or two based on the incubation period. They just release them. That happens every single day. Every single day.
And nobody's required to get a shot, right?
No. Oh, well, the agents are, but that's about it.
No, I mean the migrants. I mean, like I work for the federal government. I work for the hospital, right? I'm working for a private corporation with over 100 people. And I have to get the shot.
Mm-hmm.
Or I go broke, but they're not required to get the shot for entrance into this country. Is this true?
That's absolutely true.
It's unbelievable. Now, I'm told, I want to check it with you and do it out loud, because I'm working these phones at 2 in the morning, trying to get out there. I'm told after 7, is there some kind of decree like you don't want to hold people for more than 7 days?
We don't want to hold people more than 72 hours. You know, that's the goal. The goal is to get everybody out as fast as they can. We're pushing for 24 hours. But I think that the standard is 72 hours. But when you have 9,000 people or 15,000 people, that's not possible. The system is broke. The system is beyond broke. And nobody's trying to fix it. And, you know, I don't know, we're fast forward a little bit, but we're going to fast forward to this Haitian mess. I think what people, this whole thing with the horses, that's just a distraction. That's just look over here so you don't see what's over there.
Tell me what's under the bridge. We'll get to the horses. Tell me what's under the bridge.
Yeah, I'm not talking about the horses. The horse is just a distraction. But what's under that bridge, and I went there a couple of days ago, at the time they had gotten some people out of custody, there was 9,600 people under that bridge. It was terrible. I mean, it was disgusting. At no time, nowhere in the United States, whether you're legally here, illegally here, whether you're a convicted, maybe a child molester, deserves conditions like that, but nobody else deserves conditions of what those people are in. I mean, it is disgusting. I mean, you can smell it from a mile away. It's terrible. People living in those conditions, there's nobody should be forced to live in those conditions in the United States, anywhere in the world, but especially here in the United States. A couple weeks ago or maybe a month ago, they reinstated the Remain in Mexico program, right? So if you get caught, say you're from Colombia or Venezuela or El Salvador, you get processed and you get sent back to Mexico, remain in Mexico, right? Makes sense. Well, how come the Haitians are getting sent back to Haiti?
Oh, there's some.
They're the ones getting deported.
Let's do that for a minute. Huh. So if you want to talk about racism, again, let's focus this where there's a common ground. What Chris is saying is we're piling Haitians onto planes and flying them home, the black people. No one else is getting piled on the planes and being flown home. So, you know, Maxine Waters, if you want to create a hubbub, that's the hubbub. Not some made-up shit about whips that aren't whips. There's not a picture of anybody being struck with a rein. And if you know anything about policing on a horse, which I do because I was talking to a bunch of guys around the country I know, they use the long reins. They keep their gun hand clear in case they got to use it. And they spin that thing to distract the horse. That's a one-ton animal. It's going to kill anybody in its way, the person on top of it. And, you know, horses respond to the thing on the back. If the thing on its back does not have fear, it will not have fear. So the rein is to distract it. The rein is also used, if you've ever been in a riot or, you know, the Republican National Committee convention or Ferguson, you'll see they spin that thing to let people know to back off the fucking horse. So if you take this whole thing out, just take it out of its context and think about crowd control, because that's what it was, crowd control. That's what the horses are for. Remember what we do in the American streets with crowd control, truncheons, tear gas, rubber bullets, handcuffs, shields, right? I mean, dudes, come on, let's get serious here. This policy, Chris, from Washington, they baited this whole problem in. We're going to get rid of the Remain in Mexico policy, which was unique under Trump, which is you want asylum, you wait in Mexico for us to process you, right? Mm-hmm. Biden got rid of it. Everybody started coming. Is this correct?
That's 100%.
Okay, everybody remembers Pancho Ortiz, the baddest motherfucker on the border, mm-hmm. right? You know Pancho, Chris?
Yeah, I know him well.
He's a bad motherfucker, is he not?
Yep.
That guy covers the cartels. He covers everything. He told you that. He told you the cartels run a business. Right? Once that word gets out, they got a whole pipeline all the way down to Argentina. You did this, Washington. And look at the human tragedy you're causing. If you want to let them in, if you want to, okay, like I said, I'm listening. Let's get a lottery. You want to let hundreds of thousands of people in? We can vet them. Right, Chris?
Yeah.
But what a fucking mess. Let me ask you this. I'm talking to, there's a lot of Michigan guys in Texas, Border Patrol agents. We don't even got any anymore. So I'm being told they're getting a Biden phone. Like I was explaining to me, it was called parole. So you're not getting a court date with immigration. It's getting so bad that they're giving you a Biden phone with, you know, it's a smartphone, nice phone, and it's got a tracking device. And they're like, okay, just go ahead. And whenever you get to where you're going, check in with us then. Is that going on?
Yeah. And or they what? Give them that little bracelet around their foot, you know, but I mean, they're not going to keep that.
Wait. Let's get this clear. We're giving phones, right?
Yes. Well, not Border Patrol. Border Patrol
is the government.
Oh, yeah, it's coming from ICE or HSI or one of these other agencies.
So they're getting smartphones.
They're getting phones. Yeah,
with an account.
For what?
Okay, yeah. Go ahead.
I don't know.
Is that a tracking? I mean, is that a means of tracking? Is it? I mean,
yeah,
what is it?
A means of getting in communication with them. They can, you know, call in, let them know, because if you tell somebody, hey, when you get where you're going, check in. You know, if they don't have a way to check in, which they do because all of them have phones anyway, then that's the excuse for them not to want to check in.
Let me ask another dumb question.
Wait a minute. No, wait. Just remember that, Karen. Let's make this clear. Okay. Let's not. This is new. So you're rushing in by the thousands, right? We're setting a record this year in the history of the United States. We can't handle you, and you're getting a smartphone? Right, bro?
Yeah.
And we're paying your bill?
And benefits once you get where you're going, once you set up shop.
And then we're saying, you know, just the phone is for, you know, just give me a call. Let them know you're here. Get in line. That's what we're doing?
Yeah. And see, it used to be we would give them a notice to appear. They would have a court date.
Mm-hmm.
And it said, hey, check into this office. You have a hearing on September 3rd of 2022. Now we don't even have enough. It's so crowded down there. We're just giving them, doing the basic information, make sure they don't have any wants or warrants, and saying, hey, we're not giving you anything. You have a notice to report. So when you get over there, check in, and they'll do the paperwork there at that point.
But where's the accountability for the check-in side? And that's what I was going to ask.
There is none.
We got, who's answering the phone? Who's cross-checking that? Who says they? That's what I'm saying. So what is that? That's like another open-ended.
Well, yeah, and this whole process is open-ended. Even with a notice to appear, they're most of the time they don't show up. And the reason they don't show up, and even if they start the process, they never finish it, because over 90% of these claims are bogus claims. Living in a bad neighborhood is not grounds for a political asylum. You know, having a gang member that lives next door, you not having a job, that's not political asylum.
I agree, because I was having
all,
a dis-
all
I was
of America would be in political asylum.
I was
well,
having
and then they'd say, oh, I'm going to New Orleans or I'm going to Chicago. Really? And you're worried about bad neighborhoods and you're going to New Orleans?
I was talking to Byron this morning, the videographer for the No Bullshit News Hour. And we're talking about like 1940s, 1930s, the refugees. And I said, yeah, there's not just two sides. No immigrants or all immigrants. It's nuanced. Is there a civil war in Central America? No, there is not. A low burning one, perhaps someplace, right? Mm-hmm. Are there gas chambers? Is there a Holocaust? It's about money. The Haitians that you see are from South America. They left Haiti 10 years ago during that earthquake. They were probably the people with means who were able to get a boat and got a new way of life in South America. And as soon as the word's out, they're coming. So listen, my friends in the Philippines, get a one-way ticket to Mexico City. Pay the cartel, get a bus to the border, and just walk over, and you're going to get a fucking phone. Hey, Detroit, how you like that? You don't got a phone.
The other thing, Charlie, with this immigration thing, right, is you talk about, you know, back then, Ellis Island, give me your tired, your weak, your huddled masses, tired, weary, huddled masses. But they came in legally. They presented themselves, and they came in legally. They just sneak across the border. If the first thing you do in our country is break the law, I mean, what hope do we have that you're not going to continue to break laws?
Yeah, you know, man.
What about the people that came over on the Mayflower? They cleaned their jail. So we started out with a bunch of criminals. But no, I see what you're saying.
Yeah,
Chris.
But no, I mean, that was before our situation. Our
I know.
System.
I just wanted to make that point. You know,
no,
so
and I get it. You. I understand that. But I think what we're missing here is there are countries that are cleaning out their jails now and sending them to us. And we're just too stupid to figure it out. I mean, this has been going on since 2013. If this was a for-profit company, it would have been bankrupt years ago.
Oh, speaking of bankrupt, like, look, we're bankrupt in this country.
Well, you know, in Del Rio, they closed off the bridge in response to the Haitians coming over. They weren't coming over on a bridge. They were coming across the river, walking across. So they closed off the bridge to legitimate traffic, to commercial traffic, so that we would allow people just to walk in instead of stopping them at the river with CS gas, tear gas, whatever, and say, hey, you cannot come in this way. Present yourself at a bridge. Go about it the right way. If you have a claim, great. We'll go through the process. But if you're going to come in illegally, that doesn't give us any hope for you doing right in the future. Granted, there are a lot of good folks, I would imagine, that are trying to come to this country. And we need good people in this country. We need hardworking people. But we don't need to import any shit.
So we shut off the international bridge. Because a lot of people in Mexico have a legal right to be here. They have the papers. They've been vetted. They work. And now you can't get over. Is that correct?
Yeah, and the trucks bring in, you know, the commerce back and forth. It's shut down. Why? Because, well, we're going to turn our Border Patrol agents into church ushers.
Tell me the truth.
That's what we're doing.
Tell me the truth.
Sit down over there, sir, and you want me to get you a glass of water. Hey, do it the right way.
Tell me, bro. Tell me the truth. If a big group of migrants decided they're walking over that fucking bridge, you're not gonna stop them, are you?
No. What do you mean?
Like
on the bridge?
Yeah.
Oh, you bet your ass they'll stop them. We've had people marshal up on the south side of the bridge, 40, 50, 100 people protesting. Well, we put a big show of force. Us, customs, everybody, and their mothers out there. Blocking that bridge, but you come across the river, nobody gives a damn.
To that point, this whole Haitian, just this flood of Haitians coming over, what, 15,000, 20,000, it seemed like everybody was taken by surprise that they were on their way. I find that really hard to believe. I mean, how do you prepare for something like that? And how, shouldn't they have known that there was this flood of Haitians coming?
I mean, when you have 20,000, 30,000 people walking through a country, I mean, your intelligence should tell you that they're coming. And, you know, I feel for those people because I've been to Haiti and that hasn't been recent, but it was bad then. And now they had the all the political turmoil they're having, plus the earthquakes and all that, it's not a very pleasant place to be right now. I can imagine that's pretty bad. And I feel bad for those folks, because I think out of most of the people we see, they probably have it the worst.
Yeah.
But then they're also getting treated the worst. But then the administration is throwing up a red flag saying, oh, look at this other crap that's going on, and taking away from actually what's happened. And, you know, did you know in the last week we've had two of our buses get our buses transporting Haitians, where the Haitians attacked the bus drivers, and in one of them, 61 people escaped from the bus by assaulting our guys, you know. So, well, it wasn't ours. It was one of our contractors. But that's not being talked about.
It was a bus jacking.
Cared about that. Yeah, I mean, you know, you do something to our guys, hey, no big deal. But somebody swings a horse rein in your face, and all of a sudden the sky is falling.
Yeah.
And I know those guys on the horses. And that horse, I don't get on a damn horse. That's what killed Superman. That's a big-ass animal. I don't get anywhere near a horse. But
neither, Chris.
I got a lot of hours logged on horses. A lot.
Our horse patrol, I would put our horse patrol up against any mounted patrol in the country.
Well, I'm fucking upset here. Look, Ms. Waters and everybody else using the loaded language. My grandfather, very great grandfather, fifth generation, my people were slaves. Right? This ain't the same fucking thing. This is crowd control. So get off your ass and give me a solution. And again, you saw Kamala Harris got caught. It's horrible. I don't know. You don't have a fucking answer. The answer was remain in Mexico and do it in an orderly fashion. Like if kids show up with an adult in Mexico and apply and say my parents are there, we all can agree. Not all of us. And I respect you if you don't. We can find a place for that family. This is unacceptable. Well, I'm pro-immigration. Escúchame, amigo, fuck this. No, terrible fucking government is a human crisis.
You know, I'm okay being on the wrong side of Maxine Waters, because I don't think that woman's had a coherent thought in the last 20 years. I mean, it just with her saying something bad about me, I'm okay with it, because her opinion is just, I think she's nuts.
We got tape here. I mean, look, if this was really going down, like whips were going, like it got presented at first, you'd see it.
More than one video.
When it first came to my consciousness, I'm like, they're running around cracking whips on people, right? But I don't see it.
The guy who took the video said nobody whipped anybody. Yeah. At first they said there was bull whips out there and ropes.
Yep. New York
Charlie,
Times.
Everybody has to find something to stroke emotion, because there is no substance in what's going on in Washington.
That's the thing, though.
I mean,
that's
so...
That's what they're doing, is they're trying to get your emotion over here. And hey, look what's going on. They're whipping this poor guy when they're not, because they don't want you to see what's going on under that bridge and the terrible conditions they're in. And they don't want you to see that the only folks that are getting deported are black folks. They don't want you to see that. So they're going to say, oh, look how bad those guys in green are treating those people, when the administration is doing the back door and doing the worst possible thing they can to them. And that's the problem, and nobody wants to see it.
And for what?
And they don't want to say it either. That's the other thing.
And for what purpose? Like, here's what I hear on the right, and stop this. It really sounds like Charlottesville to me. The Democratic Party wants to create a minority base forever and change the face of America. Like, look, if you notice, Latinos are starting to vote Republican a lot. They're conservative people. So don't buy this bullshit. They're trying to replace you. And then on the other side, look, man, we got to have a system where it just rolls smooth. Everything's broken, and you're doing it for your own personal gain here in the short term. There's no long-term anything here.
What has Maxine Waters provided?
It's been broke for so long, but you have that gang mentality in Washington. I mean, you have one side, no matter what they believe, are going to vote with the party. Like that stuff with Israel and the Iron Dome and all that stuff, right? Which I'm not in Israel. It doesn't matter to me. But you had Jewish people voting against the Jewish representatives in Congress voting against it because of the party lines. What kind of crap is that? You know? I mean,
I don't know nothing about
nobody
votes
their conscience anymore. And it's on both sides. It's not one or the other. It's both sides. If the leader says this, lockstep with the leader. If the leader says that, we're locked. They're not going to cross the lines for anything because they're concerned about their own political skin. They're worried about reelection. They're not worried about doing what they were sent there to do. I don't think they should pay these guys, period. They should give them, like they do in the state of Texas, you give them a stipend to go up there and do their job. But you can't, you shouldn't be able to get rich off being a politician. That's the wrong system. That's why we're in the situation we're in.
Well, I'm going to show you how exactly you get rich as a politician and how you buy the media. And like, you know, listen, you tubalards.
You know, Charlie, speaking of buy, just let me throw this out there.
All right.
Just came across. I don't want the breaking news thing, but speaking of
breaking news, hey, Philippines. Hey, Philippines. This is when something new happens.
Dr. Khaldun, who's our state medical chief officer, is leaving for an undisclosed private sector job.
Undisclosed private sector job. That sounds to me, and I'm only speculating, she got run out or she quit. It's a fucking...
Or is she being paid like the other guy to be quiet? And this is part of that pay. I mean, who knows? It's something because you don't start dismantling your executive level staff as you enter into an election year. But let's finish this.
In the middle of a fucking crisis because COVID's through the fucking roof again. And we're oh my God, my tongue dropped out. Is that a symptom of the vax? I knew I should have got Johnson & Johnson. I mean, seriously, listen to that. We're still in this panic mode. Wait a minute.
She probably got bored. She hasn't done it. I mean, there hasn't been any state response.
Even COVID got politicized.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Jesus. Listen, stay with us, Chris, because wait, before I segue, name me some countries, not Guatemala, not Honduras, not El Salvador, not Nicaragua, and not Mexico. Name me some people coming over the border, like from what other countries?
China, Sri Lanka, India, Belarus, Romania, Pakistan, anything that has a stand in it. We get all the stands.
So does the whole world now know, just get to Mexico and just go to the border?
Yeah. I think we got a greater representation in our processing area than the Olympics. I mean, we got somebody from everywhere there.
How many people were released in the what's your sector again?
Rio Grande Valley.
Yeah, how many did you release last month?
True, I wouldn't even be able to tell you.
I got it for you. 15,000
that were released.
Yep.
That's a low number to me right there. Because
at least I have one.
Yeah, because we catch. You know, we're sitting at about 1,500 a day, what we're seeing out there. We're catching. Right now, it seems like we were starting to get more of the runners, but, yeah.
So far this year, we've had about, 1.5 million interactions, right? Apprehensions. Yeah. And yeah. What was the national record about 20 years ago was what, 1.1 million?
I think so.
Yeah, I think that's right, because I was covering the border then. So 3/4 into the year, we've set a record.
Mm-hmm.
By far.
Yeah.
Fuck me. Like, I say welcome. I want order. And we have not addressed, which we're going to do later next month, the legal workers who live in other countries, like the H-2A people, the mm-hmm. farm workers that we give permits to come work. They're supposed to be taken care of, living in clean spaces, being safe. Government's supposed to check on them. They're being fucking abused. And they make $6 an hour?
And see, to me, that's nonsense. They shouldn't get paid less than a living wage, regardless of visa or no visa. The other thing is, with these bridges being closed in Del Rio, you have a lot of people there that live in Del Rio, or that live on the Mexican side, and they come work on the U.S. side daily. Well, the next bridge is an hour away.
Common ground.
You just added 2 hours to their commute each way.
Listen to Chris Cabrera. Look, okay, whatever, man. This is a Latino man. He got long roots in Latin America, which also includes Texas, right? It's fairness. Why are we not taking care of the people doing it right? Like, look, there's room. We need you. We love good, hardworking people. We love families. right? Why on the legal shit are we ignoring it? We're going to do that.
That's the beauty of this country, is you see so many people that come over as immigrants. Detroit, for one. I mean, Detroit has a huge immigrant community, right?
Yep.
And you see so many people that come over with a lot of them next to nothing and just succeed in life and have the American dream. And that's the beauty of this country. But you got to do it the right way. And if for some reason you didn't start off doing it the right way, well, fix your shit, you know, and fix your paperwork.
Thanks for the plug.
And get on and do it the right way, because the country's full of those people. And I can tell you from being down here, people that have come over the legal way do not like to see other people take advantage of the system, because they had to go through all this hassle and all this mess to get in here and do it the right way. And they see somebody just cut the line right in front of them.
I'd rather see Joe Biden do some shit like this. Look, if you're living here and you got kids in the old country, look, get in line, file the paperwork, and we'll do what we can. It's a better way. It's a better fucking way. All right, you douchebags. Okay, stay with us, Chris. I want to show you something about, like, what our politicians, our business leaders, and our press do, this scummy little fucking pond they all swim in, and we're all on all sides of the aisle, everywhere, getting sick of them. But first, give me some Luke Nowacki music, would you? My brother were going to be listening today, but someone in the Philippines stole my shit. But that's okay, because I got another plan.
What is it?
That's thinking for the future.
And how do you do that?
Well, you know, to get my Filipino account back, I'm counting on you.
Oh,
wow. Tell me how to invest when the stock market's going up and down like a fat man on a seesaw.
Who do you call that?
I call Luke Nowacki at Pinnacle Wealth. Inflation, interest rates, what's the move? I don't know. You in the right investments?
Luke knows.
Is your pension fund meeting its projected return?
Luke knows.
Are you looking out for police, fire?
Luke knows.
Yeah, he does. How do you get a hold of Luke?
His phone number.
Yeah, that's right. It's 248-663-4748.
That's what I was thinking, yeah.
Yeah. Come on, man. Get advice. Get a strategy. Luke Nowacki, I love you, brother. And listen, if you can't get the show and you want to hear the show, you're going to need to fly to the Philippines. And you're going to need to account for that. You're calling Luke Nowacki at 248-663-4748. Hey, Zuckerberg, fix the fucking shit. And once you call Luke Nowacki, you're going to call Hall Financial, because that's really your biggest investment, right? Hall Financial closes the majority of their mortgage loans. Give me that music. Really, everything's just...
It's only a minute long.
Got a loop, Mark.
Listen, it's
only a minute long.
It's still a great time. Well, I'm giving Hall a little extra credit here.
All right, I'm sorry.
It's a great time to finance. Interest rates are still low. If you heard what the Fed said, they're going to start tapering down their purchase of Treasury bonds. We'll get to that next week. You, your money, inflation. But that means interest rates are poised to go up. I'm telling you. God damn it, listen to me. Call Hall Financial. There's money in your home, or it's a good time to buy a home, right? 4,000 five-star reviews can't be wrong, even if 1,000 of them are wrong, right? 3,000 are right.
It's not too bad.
Hey, who cares? You know, when it go like this.
Now you sound like when Gary Brown said only 10% of the city flooded.
Hey, 10%. Hey, I know, it rained. Only 10%, 90% of the city didn't flood. You know how much we need in Michigan to get our education system on track? Said one of these Buster Brown media guys up in Mackinac. $3 to $4 billion. I'm like, well, which is it? Three? Or four? Or 7 or 6? $1 billion pays for the whole city of Detroit for a year.
Charlie, and I know I say this all the time. We have been. I was watching an award ceremony yesterday.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. I say this all the time, Karen.
What?
Call 248-308-5000 or go to right. Hall. Where the fuck? What's the website?
DavidHallMortgage.com.
Yeah, it is, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't even write it down anymore because I know it, but guess what's happening?
What's happening?
You're getting old.
I'm gonna refi my house. David Hall Financial, thank you, Brett, for your support, brother. Karen, please.
No, I was just saying when you were talking about the money, and I didn't mean to interrupt you, Charlie. I'm sorry.
No, but I just wanted to finish that before we forgot.
I know, and you should. But it's like, you know, we've been talking about this. Nothing ever changes. We keep talking about money. We keep talking about equity. We keep talking about crime. We keep talking about education. We got people sitting in positions that have, the positions have existed. The people have changed. Nothing changes, and nobody complains about it. And it's like, it's kind of, you know, I was watching an award ceremony yesterday because it was virtual. And I'm thinking, if all these people being honored and celebrated were sincerely doing what they're being celebrated for, we wouldn't have these problems. But it's like people want accolades and applause without any achievements or any accomplishments.
You mean it's sort of like holding a big pig fest up on a fucking resort island, and the theme this year is inclusion and equity. Like, you think rich white guys are going to give their fucking money to the ghetto? Let's all have oysters on the half shell. Mm-hmm. And here's what I got to say about that.
Second helpings from the seafood buffet appear to be the ultimate aphrodisiac for reporters, if social media postings from the Mackinac Policy Convention were to be believed. Nothing arouses an ink-stained wretch like free heapings of oysters on the half shell.
Yes! 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 Oh!
I'll have what she's having.
Then again, there were plenty of posts bragging about the monogrammed brandy snifters, the chocolate truffles, and the pastry delights topped with real Michigan cherries. Meanwhile, back here on the mainland, people were worrying about losing their homes, a swooning stock market, and gas near $4 a gallon. Attendees call this great disconnect on Mackinac Island the Great Event. What it really is a yearly orgy where reporters spend 4 secluded days swilling high-end liquor and sucking the grapes of business tycoons and political slicksters they're supposedly holding to account for the rest of us. These poorly dressed and poorly paid reporters believe that they are equals to the 1%, when in fact, they are dancing circus dogs trained to bark on cue. Mayor Mike Duggan was up on the island. He can't seem to find the time to debate his electoral challenger down here in Detroit. But then again, why would he want anyone to be reminded that jobs are slipping away, or that there were 45 shootings last week, or that the population of Detroit continues to plummet? Indeed, Duggan hauled along his hired retinue of former reporters to spin and suck up to reporters they used to work with. This way, no real questions get asked.
And I have 6 bottles of Chateau de Tour 45 and a double jarabard of champagne.
Champagne, anyone? Yes, please. The taxpayer in America's poorest city should not worry about the mayor's lavish spending. That money does not come from them, but rather from the political donors with business before the city. Those very same donors shared cocktails with Duggan's people and their reporter pals on the great porch of the Grand Hotel. Meanwhile, the weather forecast called for 2 days of rain in Detroit, and the citizens here had their legs crossed, hoping that their basements wouldn't flood again. They didn't, but the power went out. Again. But never mind that. The cannolis have arrived.
Hi, I'm live from the Mackinac Policy Conference, where I'll be giving a keynote address.
Governor Whitmer was there, talking about futuristic visions of a new electric highway to somewhere, someplace, with no plans, while 200,000 people in Metro Detroit were sitting in the dark with no electricity. And why was Whitmer there at all? COVID cases are 5 times higher in Michigan now than at the same time last year. And remember last year when restaurants were working at half capacity, stadiums were forced to close, kids were attending class on iPad, and the Mackinac orgy was canceled? Apparently the porters don't read or remember their own copy. Then again, who does? I shouldn't care what the press does with its time. I don't watch and I don't subscribe, but apparently somebody does. And it's having a crippling effect on the rest of our lives. After 4 days of booze and brisket and peppermint whisperings in their ears, the media gets connived by the corporate overlords and their step-and-fetch-it politicos that taxing our homes is a public benefit rather than a money grab. Remember all the lead balloons floated from the Great Porch? Gilbert's publicly financed skyscraper to nowhere? Illich's publicly funded hockey arena that shares no revenue with the public? The failed Q line that the public now pays for? And the tired regional transportation plan that calls for property tax increases to pay for a choo-choo train from Ann Arbor to downtown? Who's looking out for the interests of the guy who's eating at the sign of the beef carver? That guy ain't taking no train to Ann Arbor. The press used to be hound dogs nipping at the kneecaps of the fat cats. Now they seem to be auditioning as consultants and spokespeople for the bureaucracies and corporations they're supposed to question. What the fuck? It's time to cancel the Mackinac Island orgy. The disease is infecting the rest of us. At least the White House Correspondents' Dinner is just a one-night stand.
I mean, everybody's got something to say these days.
And the people there, they're better looking. Fuck you all. Fuck you, man.
That's about it, Charlie.
It is about
it. Sad but true.
Hey, Cabrera, down there in Texas, you feel that way?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's just pause a minute. Just let everybody think. Just think. If you think we're dicks, that's fine. We're still here. Gotta live together. Now I'm gonna respect you. I believe in human dignity. I want a better life for everybody. I don't want to be pushed around and I want to be suckered. Most of all, I want children to be protected, nurtured, educated. That's what I want. And it starts at home. It starts here. It's all I got control of. Apparently we don't. So let me think about this. Whitmer talks about some pie-in-the-sky electric highway when our highways are shit. And the power grid's out. Do you really think our power grid can handle electric cars? I imagine anybody in Louisiana who had an electric car is now living in it on the side of the highway. Ain't no way to charge it. Let's just be serious. I'm for a clean world. But we can't do ridiculous jumps. We can't steal our kids' future and everybody be tricked. I'm for people being able to get around, but you seem to forget that Detroit lost 10% of its population. Let's reimagine a transportation plan. Don't tax my house where I can't see it. Be honest with me. Okay, could somebody up at Mackinac have asked Gretchen Whitmer, who's running for re-election, how she feels about Biden's vaccine mandates? Because he's lost 12% of his position with Black Americans since he's announced that. Nobody wants a piece of that. Khaldun leaves, as we heard. He's sliding. Don't tell me what to do with my body. It's not smallpox. We're not dropping like flies. We're all smart. We're all trying to be responsible. And we're hating, and they're trying to take advantage of it. Governor, do you support Biden's vaccine mandates? Easy one. Easy one, I would have asked. You know what I also would have asked? Hey, Mayor Duggan, why won't you debate your challenger? You're way ahead. You got all the money. Somebody did ask him, and you know what he answered? Because this guy, Anthony Adams, see, Anthony, I mentioned your name, so, you know, people can stop calling me. Anthony Adams, position of hate. He brings up hateful things. Anthony Adams asks you real questions. Where's the money? What about the kids? What about crime? What about property taxes? And by the way, Mayor, this isn't the first time you've been presented with a hateful opponent. You remember Benny Napoleon when you first ran in 2013. I remember because I pulled the tape.
there was no turnaround at the DMC. $50 million in, from the state of Michigan, his friend, the governor, a tax break from Wayne County Executive Fecano, $30 million in fines from the federal government for bribery, fraud, and kickbacks, millions in his pocket when he sold it, thousands of employees laid off, nurses union was busted, a $500,000 dollar salary when he started, $2 million when he left, bonds downgraded in 2010, The turnaround of the DMC is a fallacy. Fact check it. Everything I just said is true, so you need to admit it. The second thing is when you talk about changing city government, you have to take a strategic review of city services. We must make public health, safety, and welfare a priority. That's the only way you're going to change that.
I don't believe you even said that. I mean, there are some things you're going to regret when this campaign is over.
Ooh,
wow.
That was mean.
Ooh, something you're going to regret. Hey, fuck you, Leprechaun.
That's the MO, though, Charlie. This is old school gangster style politics. People keep forgetting the
Everywhere
from.
That dude went, there's a grand jury. Everywhere that dude went, there's a grand jury. There's a grand jury now. There's raids on City Hall. And you know, Mayor, you're fucking shitting. They were wearing wires. I'm getting word that the two city council people, right, the latest two, there's been four total in the last 4 months in Detroit, that not only did the feds serve warrants on their offices and their possessions, that there may have been warrants on their bodies, their person, Cabrera, law enforcement. When there is a warrant to search your body, that's usually for a dope dealer. Is that correct?
Yeah, you got something hidden somewhere.
Okay, but this ain't about dope. This is about the feds squeezing City Hall. Basically, the people they hit, they want them to roll. They don't want them to roll down. They want them to roll up. You know it, Mike. I know it. Because here's what the FBI did. If this is true, and we're working on it, I got good reason to believe it is. You go to the city council people. I got a warrant here to ram my fist up your ass. Literally. So.
Yeah.
Eh? Okay. Now, he runs for re-election again 4 years ago. Here's his other challenger, Senator Coleman A. Young II, who's probably going to be the city council president. So, Coleman, I know you're listening. You said to call you. You're going to appear on here. Or, you know, Red going to show up on your door. We don't play. James Craig, we don't play. Graduate women, we don't play. It's for the people. We don't drink no fucking cocktails that we don't pay for. Because we do enjoy a cocktail.
I don't drink.
That's right. You don't even stink, girl. Karen don't even poop.
She's kind of just confirmed it.
You know what they call her? Like, Karen's so fresh, she should be hanging from my rearview mirror. Let's roll Coleman A. Young and what he had to say. Karen, you tell us what you think.
Everywhere my opponent has been, there's been a criminal investigation. Whether he was at DMC, whether he was at DPS, whether he was at Wayne County, and now with the city. I'm not going to have my record questioned about me voting on laws or making laws when my opponent can't even follow the laws. He admitted to bid rigging and colluding on television. How is he going to criticize me on how I vote and don't vote? And we don't even know whether or not he's going to jail after this debate is over. This is the same person who had a pay-for-play scheme when he was a contractor. And while he was running for county prosecutor, if the people who he was contracting with gave him money, he would in turn give them contracts. This is going to criticize me. He has had a level of criminal investigation everywhere he's been. He had to pay $30 million to the federal government for violating anti-kickback laws. He admitted on Fox 2 News in front of Charlie Duff on television that he met with three contractors, that he had a negotiated price for those contractors. Those three contractors got the bids, and then he put the bids out for everybody else a couple days later. If that's not bid rigging, I don't know what is.
It's LaDuff.
Only one inaccuracy there, Charlie. It's LaDuff.
Thank you. I loved it. I was like, I don't even get to be a moderator, and this is my fucking debate.
But, you know, people forget there was another interview. And I remember very clearly because he said, you know, he admitted to doing it and then said, I lost sleep over this. And I'm thinking like, dude, people are in jail for this and you lose sleep and that's a sufficient trade-off? People just aren't, nobody's fact checking, Charlie. Nobody's fact checking. Nobody's asking questions. Nobody's asking for any substantiation of the claims.
They'll wait. They'll wait for us to do it because they like to eat their fucking oysters. Mm. Oh, and by the way, this, I got two things, so hopefully I can remember them. Sorry, dude. There was a guy up there. I wrote that thing about 2 o'clock, turned it in. They got posted at 10. About 5 o'clock. There was actually a reporter up there who tweeted himself eating the fucking oysters. God. I wasn't personally calling you out. I didn't even know. You just, you're a cliche. Mm-hmm. You're a living fucking cliche. I predicted it. You did it. I didn't call you out. Because if I was going to call you out, I'd use it by name. But you called yourself out. Number two, I got some breaking news.
Oh.
Breaking news, no bullshit news hour. Yes, the demolition investigation is alive and well. The criminal division of the Department of Justice is, in fact, continuing to dig into that dirty demolition deal. In my opinion, that dirty demolition deal. But one of the sticking points is this. They don't know what to do with Detroit. If they find it, can Detroit handle it? If they find it, would the federal government ever send any more money for public works projects like demolition? This is the kind of shit Duggan's doing behind closed doors. You know it, Mike. I know it. I got a fucking line in there. Right? Like, again, this is like the UAW getting the wrist slap, right, for being corrupt, and the feds say we don't want to penalize the dues payer. This is like Quicken Loans ripping everybody off on those mortgages after the collapse and getting a $35 million fine and Quicken Loans calling it a victory. No, you did it. You paid the fine. And like all Wall Street slicksters, you got a piece of paper said nobody admits any guilt. Now, what is Rocket Mortgage? What is Rocket, you know, Quicken Loans, new public entity? What's that going for? Let me get that, Mark. Right, the Quicken goes public, sold it for 18 to the institutional investors, 20 to the public. It's going to be gangbusters, like the pigs up at Mackinac, that right stuff, right? The pigs up at Mackinac, that right stuff, say it's going to be a great stock. We're going to come back. It's now trading under $17. You lost on that one. We told you that. We told you this, guys. Come on, man. You know what? You know what, Chris? I want my mommy. Is my mom on the phone?
Yes.
Hi, Ma.
Hi, honey.
Mom, I'm not faking it, am I? I say I'm on the radio. When you and I get together and smoke some cigarettes and drink the coffee, this is how I sound, isn't it?
Pretty much.
And you get mad at me sometimes because I don't call.
Pretty much.
Because I'm kind of a dick.
Well, I'll leave that one alone.
I wanted to, you can't see him, but on with us is Chris Cabrera. He's a Border Patrol agent in Texas. He's the vice president of the National Border Patrol Council. Chris, say hi to my mom, Evangeline.
Hello, ma'am. How are you?
Good afternoon, Chris. I'm well. God bless you guys.
Thank you.
And I don't know if you've ever met Karen, but Karen's a dear friend of mine. Really,
I met your mom at your house years ago. You had your brother there, and I met your mom there.
Hello, Karen.
Hi, how are you? Nice to hear you.
And yourself.
Thank you.
But, Mom, go ahead and Chris, kiss Chris's ass for a second.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead and continue with kissing Chris's ass.
Well, I'll tell you something. Somebody out here has to, because those sons of... Sorry about that. If you watch this crap on television, you would think that the whole country is against these guys. They're not. And I think, it's not good to talk about. I think what they're doing to these people is just, I'm watching my orcas right now on the...
on the TV?
It makes me sick.
Why? What's making you sick about it? What's he saying now?
Well, he's up there making his first thing about on the border. And never mind, you know, these thousands and thousands of people that you see from the aerial shots and the telephones. And, you know, he's up there, well, it's Trump's fault. And his biggest thing was these gentlemen on horseback with their quote-unquote whips, you know, that evoke the days of slavery and, you know, that's a big catch here. Never mind the crux of the problem that's going on.
And how do you see it, Miss Middle America? What's the crux of the problem, Ma?
Well, you call it what you want to, Charlie. I call it a damn invasion.
Okay. I mean, I can't, I would use a different word because there's nobody, you know. Well, Chris, Mom, I wish you were at my mom's table. An invasion implies that it's planned. And in a way, it is planned. Well, let's, Ma, listen to the Vice President of Border Patrol. In a way, Chris, the cartels kind of do plan and move all this. Aren't they the logistics company?
Well, not only are they planning it, the people plan to come across. I mean, you don't take a trip of that magnitude just off the seat of your pants. You know, they're coming over because they know they can. They know they're going to get away with it. It's like a 4-year-old, in the kitchen trying to touch stuff, and you tell him not to. As soon as you turn your back, he's doing it again. You know, get away with what they can while they can. And that's exactly what we're dealing with here. They know there's free stuff, and they're going to get it while the gravy train's on.
Ma?
Yep.
What strikes me about that is he said, you know, you tell a 4-year-old no. I don't remember being told anything.
You were never told no?
Well, my therapist wanted me to confront you about this. I was only told. You remember? Do you remember when I was like 8 months old and I was saying my first word and I wanted some milk from your breast and you told me you just wanted to be friends?
No, I don't quite remember that.
Thank God.
We won't go into it.
Finally.
What? Hey, my mom has worked her ass off her whole life. She's on a fixed income. Are you worried, Mom, about inflation?
Absolutely. I go to the grocery store. I'm not like these folks that are making the laws.
I want you to speak, because I know they listen. These piggies in the press, like, tell them about the cost of food and what that's doing to you.
I probably would say immediately, don't defame pigs.
Snap! Okay, these hogs.
No, I can't say it, but I may another.
But
time.
What's food doing to your budget, Ma? I know you're peckish, you're thin, you're still really, you know, I don't sexy. That's weird. Like, we'll take that out.
No, we won't.
You're a good-looking gal. You keep yourself together. You don't eat a lot. You're a single woman, but it's costing you, is it not?
Of course it is. You know, with me, basically, you know, it's good. You know, I can get by, but do I notice it? Absolutely. You know, I sit the month before, and I know my bills for the following month, and so on and so forth. Yeah, you go to the grocery store, people that are raising families, you know, those are the idiots in the middle, you know, the deplorables and the unwashed. But not only are the prices of groceries going up, but the packaging is smaller. So mm-hmm. It's a double.
And what about your water bill, Ma?
There again, I can only base it on myself because I just have myself to monitor, but I do watch my utilities, absolutely.
Has your price gone up for,
yeah,
like, and you don't know why over the last couple of years?
No. In fact, when it first went up, I called on it, and it was quite a few years ago. My fixed charge is higher than my actual water usage.
Hey, Mom, I want to bring Karen. And Karen, your water bill?
Well, Charlie, we're still trying to resolve it. We've got about $4,000 in escrow while we try to get them to figure it out. We tried to get a hearing before the Board of Water Commissioners. Did not happen. Talked to the water department. They finally came out and said, let's switch the meter. We've had our master plumber check the house. No leaks. They took the meter. 2 weeks later, they said, okay, calm down. We'll test it. Well, you've compromised it. How do I know that's my meter? What have you done to it in the interim? And who's policing the police? They said, oh, there's nothing wrong with it. We do not use an excessive amount of water. They said between 7 and 8 in the morning. We don't have 9 to 5s. Sometimes we're not up between 7 and 8 in the morning. So it's a lot.
They're
it
sticking
a
us.
Lot.
Hey, Cabrera, what about your heating bill in Texas this last winter? What did that do?
Yeah, we didn't really have much of one because the power went out, so.
Power went out.
So,
but the bill still showed up.
We didn't have much of a heating bill, so usually our heating bill is not too bad. So air conditioning, that's a different story. It's hot down here.
So, and has your price remained stable? Is it going up? I know your grid's no good, so.
No, our grid's good. It's just, I mean, it got unseasonably or abnormally cold. Just kind of like how you guys freak out in the rain. You know, we're good with that because we get hurricanes down here. It gets cold down here. We don't know how to act. So, but yeah, you know.
Okay, listening to you. Okay, so what about the price of chew?
That's gone up.
That's gone up too much, huh?
Yeah, I mean, and even like electricity has gone up a little bit. I'm on a co-op, so mine's not too bad. But some people, yeah, the prices have shot up. I mean, everything, gas,
ammo.
The cost of, one of my nephews is building a house, and man, that the cost of everything's gone up for him. I think the price has jumped. Like he's paying like $20,000, $30,000 above what he should have been paying.
What about ammunition?
Ammunition's hard to find. Ammunition's hard to find. It's expensive.
Karen, I mean, ammunition?
Dollar a round, man.
Well,
dollar a round.
It's expensive, and it's also, it feels like it's in short supply. I mean, fortunately, I know the owner of the shop, so I was able to make sure that, you know, I could get what he had access to. But yeah, everything is, like your mom said, things are smaller, the portions are smaller, the prices are higher. And, you know, I think we're going to see some empty shelves as the weather starts to shift around here, Charlie. Toilet paper and water have been kind of difficult to find. I haven't seen anybody really say anything about it. But you've had to search far and wide, and it's different. It's different, guys.
Mom,
for toilet paper, just use a cabbage because it's organic and it's cheaper. You get the whole big old cabbage.
Cabbage?
Yeah, hey,
Mom,
it's cheaper.
Mom, and for you, Mom, what about the price of cocaine?
It's gone up substantially. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Fucking my mom can't even afford her. Just a little toot.
Yeah.
You know, just, you know, an old gal earned her way. You know, I mean, it's legal sure. Now, isn't it?
Pretty much.
Well, gambling's legal. Weed's legal. Why not make
might
coke?
As well be, yeah. You
know. I don't go there anymore. Back in the
I don't go there anymore.
I'm so stupid, I'd probably lay a line of flour.
I'd lay a line of flour. Wait a minute, Mom. You said I don't go there anymore. Have you ever done cocaine?
No.
No, I know. You want to?
No.
No, me either, man. They're putting weird shit in it. It kills people.
Yeah. You know how I feel about drugs, but that's another issue.
How do you feel about drugs?
I don't really kind of live in the positive direction, honey.
Me, you know, I...
Just...
I know.
Just don't.
I know.
Of course, I'm beginning to wonder if this world we're living in, maybe everybody should take drugs. Maybe it wouldn't seem so surreal.
You know what's funny about that is during Trump's time, you know, the bestseller.
The guy that sent the mean tweets.
Yeah, the mean tweet guy, the racist guy, the Capitol guy, you know. But, but the bestseller was 1984, George Orwell, Big Brother's Watching You, Double Speak, What is Not, What's Not Is, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I don't believe that should have been the bestseller. The best book was Brave New World by Huxley, which was people willingly gave their freedom away. They entertained themselves to death. The government gave them drugs, and they had copious sex, free sex.
Mm-hmm.
And I really feel that's what society looks like.
Yeah, I don't think you're far from it, honey. I guess I would probably say, yeah, bring on the drugs and, you know, nothing but animals in the barnyard, and off we go.
Wait, what do you mean, like, bring on the drugs? You got some drugs?
Who?
You.
I've got some Advil.
And the price of that went through the roof.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
No, it is, like I say, I don't know with people raising children right now. I just, the cost of things is, it's just something I've paid attention to all my life, and I look at it and think, my God, you know, if I was raising, you know, with my family, you know, 5-6 children, I'm not sure what they're doing.
See how my mom's had 5-6 children? We're up and down. We're alive. We're dead. We're from a real place. I love this woman. You should all love and respect this woman. And you know what, Ma? You know the brickwork of yours is starting to crack a little bit. You know, upkeep of the house. It's hard to find a good brick worker.
So is my face, honey. We'll both get by.
Okay. But, oh, mommy. But listen, all you people out there looking for work, my mom needs somebody. I did what I could, but I'm not great at brickwork. And we need bricklayers, right? So listen, bricklayers and allied craft workers, Local 2, need skilled bricklayers and caulkers to help build and restore projects throughout Michigan. Want better pay, a real pension that won't run out, and fully paid health care benefits, and up to $2,000 for a signing bonus just to learn how to do it? Don't wait. The demand for skilled trowel trades is at an all-time high, Mom. They have apprenticeships and free training opportunities for those looking to get started in a great career. Start building your future now and go to bricklayers.org and click Join BAC. You were just in the middle of a commercial.
I assume that was the case because I didn't think you wanted me to apply.
She needs to be compensated, Charlie. That was an endorsement from your mom, quietly, but still.
I bring her Coney kits once in a while. Yes, look at that, a double commercial. Do you like those Coney?
Yes, I do.
Oh, you love them. The chili's unbelievable, right?
I think it's probably one of the best hot dogs I've ever had.
And you know what? If you want a Lafayette hot dog, you can buy it in the gas station.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
You wouldn't notice the difference.
I'll bring you another kit, Mom, or you could, of course, go to AmericanConeyIsland.com. Oh, you're in another commercial.
Yes, I still have a couple in the freezer for a kit for Mia's. Do me a favor and take it to some family with some kids.
Okay, we'll take it to the border. Chris, we've got leftover hot dogs.
give it to the guys that are watching it from our side, would you?
Hey, Chris, could you do this? Listen, because my mother is a really beautiful, humanistic person. Don't answer, Mom. Just let me do this. It's true. Like, she is just a super, I can't tell you the children she's taken in. I can't tell you. What a spectacular woman this is. She really is. Chris, would you, for us, in the name of humanity, I want to send a Coney kit to you. Will you give it to a family underneath that bridge in Del Rio? Would you drive there? It's got to be 4 hours, 3 hours for you. Would you drive and give it to them for us and tell them we don't hate?
Yeah.
Fucking beautiful.
If I could interrupt you there, honey, my orchestra just announced that there's nobody left under the bridge.
Wait, hold on. Wait. Breaking news. This just in from my mom watching television in suburban Detroit. There are no longer any Haitians under the bridge in Del Rio, Texas. We now take you to McAllen, Texas, to Chris Cabrera, Vice President of the National Border Patrol Council. Mr. Cabrera, are there in fact no migrants under the bridge as we speak?
I don't know. I'm pretty sure there's not. I know they were trying to demolish everything. That doesn't mean nobody's around. They just moved them somewhere and hit them.
That's correct.
They're pretty good at that. Like when we get the big wigs coming down from D.C., we have people under our bridge over here, and they ship them off somewhere to one side of our area. And when the little convoy goes to that area, they ship them right back. So they're hidden, you know. So that's all they're doing. They're just hiding them.
Can you get on the phone? Can you get on the phone right now? Before we go up to you, make that call, mute yourself, and then report back to us.
All right, let me check right now. Okay. I might have it on here.
Okay,
yeah,
okay.
He's still on. I can't hear him, but he's still up there on the podium.
Okay, Mom, while we're waiting, I want you to ask me a question. I want you to repeat what I ask you. You ask me, we'll edit it later, like it just naturally happened. You ask me, gun to your head, Charlie, Trump or Biden? Go ahead.
You want me to ask you?
Yeah, yeah. We'll fix this in post like it just came out of nowhere.
Sure.
Okay.
Tell me when.
3, 2, 1. Action.
Okay, gun it to your head, Charlie. Would you choose what we have or Trump?
Well, okay, take two. Take two. Okay, Trump or Biden. I like how you're working with it, but, you know, as a writer, I don't like my lines being changed. So,
sorry.
Let's do this again. Yeah, I'm Andrew Sorkin. Okay, I'm a stickler, method acting, Mom. So, I want you to think good things about me, all the nice things I've done, not the bad things. I come over and I'm nice, right? Okay, gun to your head, my son.
All right, gun to your head.
Okay, wait, let me count down. Hold on a second. Hold on. Okay. You think Hollywood's so easy. Okay. 3, 2, 1.
gun to your head, my son, would you choose Trump or Biden?
Pull the fucking trigger. Oh, damn.
I gotta say, that was delivered very well, though.
Thank you. What do you think of that answer, Mom?
Not much.
Oh, Mom, and I want you to really let it out. Let your F-bombs out. Why did you, if you don't mind, listen, we'll take this out. We'll do this in post. This is just between me and you and everybody listening in the Philippines. Okay, you don't mind if I tell them you voted for Trump, right?
No, I'm proud of it.
Okay, good. Okay, so action. Mom, why did you really vote for Trump?
The first or second?
The first.
First time I voted for him, I knew, you know, she had a track record. I knew what Clinton was. Trump, I voted for him at first because I just thought, got nothing to lose. Give him a chance.
Like nothing to lose because the Republicans and the Democrats had been lying to you your whole life?
No, just because I knew the Clintons' record. I mean, you know that they do, but some are just, you know, just snakes. And, you know, some are just worms.
But in the primary, when you had a choice between Bush and whoever else was in that thing, you chose the anti-establishment guy.
I did.
Why did you not go for an establishment Republican?
Because I just, through the years, have watched them and... I just think that they compromise, they sell out. You know, I don't think that, you know, the things that the laws that they work on, you know, were so detrimental to the country like I do now. But I just got tired of people that just went along to get along. So.
As you once said to me, I was sick of fucking being lied to.
Yeah. That's basically it. The whole thing. Did I want something new? Yeah. I liked the things he said, and I thought, okay, if he's any different than the rest, and if he honors half of what he's saying, that will be pleasant. So that's how we got my first vote.
And how did he get the second?
He got the second because I felt he was a man of his word. Stood up there and he took it. He didn't seem to. Wasn't compromised. There again, you didn't have a guy that, quote-unquote, went along to get along, stood his ground. I just like the guy's metal.
Okay, and I respect it. You see, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to hate my mama? Fuck out of here. Get the fuck out of here. I don't hate anybody. I don't. Breaking news.
Mm-hmm.
Breaking news. Live and exclusive from the Texas border, Vice President of the National Border Patrol Council, Chris Cabrera, tells us the update from the Del Rio Bridge in the Del Rio sector along the border of Texas. Mr. Cabrera.
Yeah, they're gone.
Well, Mom.
They cleared them out.
Wow.
There's still some others crossing right behind them, but they're still dealing with them. But
any idea where they took them, Chris?
No, you know, I think a lot of them probably got released. They just released them into the country.
So it worked.
Yeah, I mean, they got their way, you know.
Well, we're going to see later. I mean, make a few calls and we'll update it. Maybe they're getting deported or being put on planes.
Well, and again, even if they are, you know, that's a little different than what's happening to the rest of the world that's coming in. They're getting differential treatment, you know, and I think Haiti's that's a rough place. And they haven't lived in Haiti for some time. They've been coming from Chile and some other places from South America.
So the great question for the reporters, and if I was still down there covering it, I just might go. Where did the United States send anybody on these planes? Did you send them back to Haiti where they haven't lived in a decade? Or did you send them back to Chile where, you know, they had made a life? So that's an important one.
To Mexico where everybody else is getting sent.
Yeah, you know, like I said, Chris, we should make a deal with the Taliban that all the people we left behind, just fly them into Mexico City and then catch a bus up to Agua Prieta, and you can just walk over. Fuck it.
You want some more breaking news, Charlie?
Yes, breaking news. Mark.
Why not? Let's just pile it on.
Look at this show, Mom.
Chris Cuomo has been accused of sexually harassing a veteran TV news exec in 2005 by squeezing her buttocks at a party. So now he joins his brother in the sexual harassment circle.
Na 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 na. Hey, orderly. Breaking news.
Oh boy, another one?
Yeah. According to information gathered exclusively by the No Bullshit News Hour that took 1 year to get from the Duggan administration, that 6 months before the pandemic, the shooting of children 17 and younger increased by 60%, thus having nothing to do with the COVID lockdown or George Floyd. Breaking news. From March 10th until May 25th, before George Floyd was killed and nobody was released from lockdown in their houses, the number of shootings of children in Detroit increased 300%. Breaking news.
Wow.
The shooting of children in Detroit from 2019 to 2020 increased by 100%. Breaking news. According to data obtained exclusively by the No Bullshit News Hour, the homicides from gunfire of children 17 and younger in Detroit increased by 333%. Breaking news. A child in Detroit is 10 times more likely to be shot than the average American child.
Wow.
Breaking news. One in every 20 children in America who dies from gunfire was a resident of Detroit.
Holy shit.
So.
That's crazy.
The chief of police wants to run and be the governor. The mayor of Detroit wants to run and tell me life's gotten better. Explain it. Mom.
Explain it. I guess it's a, you know, Hitler's cabal had it all. You know, it's you tell a lie, it's little. You tell a lie and you tell it often, tell it big, and it becomes the truth.
You know what else Hitler said? You'd be surprised how cheap people sell themselves.
That's correct.
God.
They're not taking our freedom, Charlie. We're giving it.
Well, you know, I'm this, Mom. I'm here for the children. I know you are. I know what life
I'm
you
so
live.
Pro-life, Charlie, but I believe these people, if you can't tell, you know, they call it, you know, these same people that with the children. It's either a choice or it's a child. You know, take your pick. Take your side. And if you regard life as a choice, you can't really appreciate the child.
And you know what this tells me? There's a lot of fucking assholes who live in Detroit. Number one. Number two, we're not paying police. So, there's enough to go around. Somebody talk for real. And before we go, I want to tell you something. I'm very proud of this, right? This is the Strong Hearts Native Helpline. If you're hurting in your relationship and you want to talk, Strong Hearts Native Helpline is here to listen. Strong Hearts is a free 24/7 confidential anonymous domestic dating and sexual violence helpline for Native Americans and Native Alaskans. Connect with an advocate by calling or texting 1-844-7-NATIVE, NATIVE, or by using the chat icon at strongheartshelpline.org. And in true Native fashion, Mom, as our people do, it's open to anybody that needs help. So avail yourself of it. Cabrera, you got any more news there?
No, not at all.
All right.
I had a question, though.
Okay.
You sent me those Coney packages for those people, right?
Yeah, where are we going to take them?
And when I'll get them to them, but how are they going to refrigerate them?
I'm assuming they're going to cook them right away, bro.
Okay. All right.
See, look at that. Look at me. I'm a genius. You know why? Good stock, my mom.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How are they going to cook them, Charlie, under a bridge?
They should go to the guys at the border.
Yeah, I think it's a good thought, but I mean, by the time he drives it 4 hours, even though it's packed, what are they going to do with them when they get them?
Yeah, give them to the guys at the border. Our guys, You know, they're taking a beating in the press. For God's sake, give them a damn hot dog.
Okay, we're going to set two. Okay, so here's what we want, Chris. As you apprehend people, I want to give them a Coney dog. And then I want you to eat the Coney dog, and I want you to sing Kumbaya.
I'm going to have to look up the words to that, but I'll do it.
And listen, we can send you some Lafayette dogs, right? And you're not even going to have the horses. You don't even have to have the horses with the reins. You don't have to whip these hot dogs because they already got the whip marks from when the jockey was hitting them. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, you know, I got a neighbor. He told me he's from Detroit. His dad was Detroit PD a long time ago. And he told me to stay away from the Lafayette dogs.
Whoa! Hey. He said America's the way to go, right?
And that's what he said.
That's what he said. They know that in Texas. And with that, Cabrera, thanks. Be safe, brother.
All right. Well, I appreciate it. And, ma'am, it was nice to talk to you.
You as well, sir. Be well. Take care.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Bye, Karen. Bye, guys.
Bye, Chris.
Wait, Chris. Wait, one more thing before we go. Mama?
Yes.
Will you tell me something good about myself?
You have a good big ego.
Bitch.
Be nice.
Well, you do it first.
Pardon?
Did I say something?
What happened?
Did that come out of my head?
It's crazy.
I'm sorry. I love you, Mom.
Charlie, next time your mother sees you, she should slap you.
I will.
She's a term of endearment.
She will. She taught me the word.
No, it's not.
You should hear how she talk about her, Ma.
Well, that's a different story. I'm talking about you talking
and
about her.
By the way, Mom, you know, like that pig fest they have on Mackinac Island with the media and the government and the billionaires?
Mm-hmm.
That's our homeland.
That it is.
You know, the McGulpin house at the bottom of the fort?
Yes.
Okay. Did you not, when your parents divorced and you had no place to go, did you not live in that thing without the running water? And
before they moved it to the island, yes.
Yeah, you lived in that, didn't you?
Uh-huh.
And then many years later, my daughter's doing Girl Scouts and standing a guard over it as the governor's guard. And it came full circle. That's our home. That's grandma's birthplace and great-grandma's birthplace and great-great-grandma's birth and great-great-great-great-grand. That's our place.
Yeah, your great-grandmother's. House where Mom was raised is right behind St. Anne's Church.
That's right. So you know what? Take your stupid garbage brandy snifter bullshit and get the fuck off my island. You ain't doing nothing for us.
They don't do anything anywhere, so find your peace in that.
See that? So you all can hate me, but if you hate me, I got it from her. You hate her? You got a war.
They don't want to miss a cocktail party, so they have to ask the right inane questions.
Well, Governor, this sounds really fantastic. Electric highway to nowhere, but my power's out.
Yeah, what kind of ice cream do you like?
Okay, I love you, Mom. Have a great
love
one.
You too.
Karen, love you. Mark, love you. Hey, yeah. Philippines.
Goodbye, everyone.
See you next week, Philippines.
Now you can give them the finger, Charlie.
Right there. No. I give Zuckerberg the finger. Something I do.